Good morning. Each party will have 15 minutes which to present their case. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you're the appellant and you wish to reserve that time, please let me know when you come up to the front podium. There, I'm keeping track of the clock, and we'll keep you apprised of the passage of time. But we haven't read your briefs, and we're ready to proceed when you are.
I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal, please.
Thank you.
I'd like to begin by making three key points for why the unjust enrichment verdict in this case should be overturned. First, the unique dollar number in this case shows that it was improperly based on contract damages. Second, Taser offers no alternative explanation for that specific number. And third, Taser offers no case where the court compares the evidence to the particular number, which shows an obvious error, and the court ignores it. The improper basis for the unjust enrichment verdict is apparent on its face. Taser asked the jury for a very specific number for consequential contract damages, $462,000 to $128,000. And even though the category of damages that supported that number could not support an unjust enrichment award, the jury awarded that exact amount, that identical amount down to the dollar, for unjust enrichment. It's undisputed that a jury cannot award additional compensation under an unjust enrichment theory where the contract governs, so the verdict should be overturned. Taser throws up its hands and says, well, this is sheer coincidence. It's too speculative to go this far. But we cited many cases in our briefs where appellate courts apply common sense and they overturn a verdict in these circumstances. This court, in the Crosby case that we cited, compared the verdict number to the evidence and concluded that the jury failed to award the appropriate categories of damages. This court in Telchon said that a peculiarly specific number on the verdict form, that again mapped onto a number in the evidence, shows error in the verdict. And that's paragraph 18 of that decision. Taser, in contrast, offers no case that faced that scenario and went the other way. I think it's important to understand that these particular categories of damages can't support unjust enrichment, and Taser has never pointed to an alternative explanation for that number. Taser's theory was that Republic breached the contract by failing to pay money, and that Taser ended up owing its subs and tradespeople interest and attorney's fees and liquidated damages on those outstanding amounts, so that those were consequential to the breach of contract. Taser charted out those damages, summed them up on the chart to reach this $462,000 number, put that in front of the jury, and walked the jury through the verdict form so it could see that these were part of their contract damages. And it never argued that those damages corresponded to any value or benefit to Republic, which would be required for unjust enrichment. And in fact, the parties disputed whether these damages could go to the jury at all. Taser offered them, and the court accepted them as consequential contract damages. And as I've mentioned before, there's been no alternative explanation for where that number could come from. So in sum, because the entire unjust enrichment verdict rests on an improper basis, this court should order a judgment notwithstanding the verdict to Republic on the unjust enrichment claim. I'd also like to address the contract cap argument. So as we've discussed in our brief, Ohio law requires a clear, unequivocal, and decisive act to get around the maximum price term in a construction contract. And Ohio courts enforce that high standard so that parties can negotiate meaningful limits at the outset and their construction contracts that will later be enforced in this very kind of scenario where there's a concern about runaway costs. Taser agreed to those terms. It agreed to a maximum price term, and it agreed to a process for revising that, and it did not follow that process. Taser set the price in the second purchase order. It calculated what it wanted to receive or needed to receive to finish the work. It put that number to Republic, and Republic accepted it without further negotiation. It was also very clearly part of the prerequisite for this second purchase order that this be the maximum price, and that if Taser wanted to exceed it, it had to ask for more money. get a revised purchase order. So TASER knew what it needed to do. This term was in all caps on the first page of this purchase order, and it was discussed between the CEOs of the companies. It was a very clear prerequisite to this agreement. TASER also knew early on that it was exceeding the contract cap. Within a few weeks of signing the second purchase order being issued, it had already billed, invoiced Republic, $3 million of the $3.7 million contract cap. But it didn't do what it was supposed to do about that. It didn't ask for more money under a revised purchase order, and it didn't get Republic to waive the contract cap. TASER now can't escape the consequences of its agreement to assume the risk of a maximum price term, because there's no evidence that that crucial term was waived here. And I'll go through a few of these items of evidence that TASER points to and tries to rely on. The email that they rely on very heavily in their briefing, it doesn't even mention price. So for clear and unequivocal, decisive waiver to mean something, then the term being waived, at the very least, should be part of that writing, that discussion. They also say that the fact that the project was being more directly managed is evidence of a change in the price or a waiver. But that just goes to how the work was managed. It doesn't address how the parties were going to pay for the work or how much they would pay for the work. I would point the court's attention to the Maggie and Savage decision. That's a 10th District's decision that we cited in our briefs. And that in that case, the court makes a similar distinction. One of the parties argued that when the other side directed additional work, they waived contractual limits on compensation. And the 10th District rejected that argument because those are two different aspects of the relationship, what work is being done and how much is being paid for that very work. I'd also like to point the court's attention to Exhibit 39, which was also cited in our briefs. That's TASER's own email with the proposal for the second purchase order. They call it a time and materials proposal with a not to exceed amount. So this notion that time and materials, not to exceed maximum price, are mutually exclusive, I think is belied by TASER's own communications in this case. And lastly, they say that there's evidence that they agreed to work things out later, but the testimony at those transcript pages has to do with work outside the scope of the contract, extra work, not work that was within the scope of the contract and therefore governed by the contract cap. And lastly on this point, I'd just like to emphasize that this was properly raised below. This provision on the purchase order was read to the jury several times, and the waiver argument was part of the jury instructions and in closing arguments. And doing more would have been asking the court to make a hypothetical ruling before the jury had reached its verdict. Courts apply contract caps after the verdict is reached all the time. In fact, in tort reform, in the statutes on tort reform, the parties in the court, they're not allowed to inform the jury about what the cap is under tort reform. And so the caps only apply after the jury returns with its verdict. We also cited cases in our brief for the proposition that remitter doesn't require a prior limiting instruction. So we would ask the court to order remitter, as we've outlined in our brief, to the amount that would be allowed under the contract cap. And lastly, I'd like to spend a moment on the jury instructions. And for this issue, the meaning of the contract, legal duties in the contract, that's a question of law for the court. Republic objected to the court abdicating that duty and not tying its instructions to the contract because, quite simply, the jury shouldn't be interpreting the contract. TASER, in contrast, told the court that it was irrelevant whether a provision was in the contract or not. And as a result, the court ended up instructing the jury that it could find breach based on duties that are not in the contract. TASER claims that some of the breaches are grounded in the contract, so the two-issue rule means that there's no reversal. But where an instruction should not have been given, prejudice is still presumed, and that's the Wagner and Hample decisions that we cited in our briefs. Here, TASER fails to show the jury was correctly instructed in the law, and any of the duties that were enumerated for the jury could have been a basis for the jury's verdict, so we would ask the court to send back the breach of contract claim for a new trial. If there are no questions at this time, I'll reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal.
Thank you.
Your Honor, as we are both appellees and cross-appellants, we'd ask for two minutes to reserve at the end, if that's possible, to respond to any issues with regard to the cross-appeal.
You have 15 minutes to answer. You're going to have to do both in the same amount of time.
Oh, of course. I wasn't expecting additional time. I'd like to see if we reserve 2 minutes to deal with that.
Are you understanding that you can't get back up?
I was hoping to get back up.
That's what she's trying to tell you. You just have to do everything right now.
Then I will go 15 minutes.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure we were all on the same page. Sorry.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Good afternoon. May it please the court. My name is Jeff Brower, and I'm one of the attorneys for Appellee and Cross-Appellant, Tessar Industrial Contractors. Tessar is a small, 95-year-old family-owned business, which in 2013 served as the structural steel contractor for Republic Steel. Tessar's work was a small portion of a $130 million multi-prime project. After 4 weeks, 14 witnesses testifying, and almost 500 exhibits admitted, Tessar asked the jury to award it damages for in-scope and out-of-scope work in the amount of $3,893,000. The jury awarded $3,078,000 for breach of contract and $462,128 for unjust enrichment. The jury was not allowed to hear Tessar's claim for fraud in the inducement because the claim was directed out of the close of evidence. Each of the three bases for appeal asserted by Republic are improper. First, Republic is wrong in its demand that Tessar's damages for breach of contract should be reduced, as Foster Wheeler expressly provides for an exception for waiver, and Tessar offered extensive evidence of waiver at trial. Second, Republic is wrong in its challenge of the jury instructions after the fact, because the breach of contract instructions track the approach set forth in the OJI and were well-founded in law. Third, Republic is wrong in asking this court to speculate as to jury error in the jury's award of unjust enrichment, because where the jury was properly instructed, properly answered jury instructions, and was properly polled and nonetheless held to the number. On each of the three Republic claimed errors, the jury heard evidence and sided with Tessar. The sole error that the trial court made was preventing the jury from considering its fraud in the inducement claim. The first issue is the modification provision. Tessar offered and the jury heard evidence of written waiver in the form of an email from project manager Mark Qualls, in which he told Tessar and all Republic senior management on the project that Republic will directly manage people working here on a time and material basis. These terms, directly manage and time and material basis, are construction terms describing the way of handling a project. The definitions were the subject of extensive testimony by fact and expert witnesses, and those witnesses testified that under time and materials, an owner controls what a contractor does, essentially paying by the hour. And of equal importance, Tessar offered evidence from numerous witnesses of clear, unequivocal, decisive acts, demonstrating Mark Qualls did what he wrote. He directly managed the project by running meetings, assigning Tessar subcontractors to do specific tasks, including as little as sorting of bolts, ordered Tessar to rent equipment, and otherwise proceeded to shift the work to a time and materials basis. The testimony from numerous witnesses was that Republic took over the project. Now, on cross-examination, Mark Qualls confirmed that he directed the work before issuing purchase orders. I'll ask the court to look at transcript at 2397. Question to Mr. Qualls, but just so I've got it right, there were times in which you directed work to Tessar before a formal purchase order was issued, correct? It would appear, yes. That's Mr. Qualls speaking. Also, Republic's own expert conceded at trial that my client's not going to like this, but Republic and Tessar had a working system whereby Republic Steel project manager Mark Qualls would direct work and then assign work. And all of this was done separate and apart from any procedure that was laid out. Ultimately, in evaluating this issue, the court should properly defer to the trial court. As Ninth District precedent, such as Jemison and Desai's held, when a party seeks to argue that the evidence was not substantial enough to demonstrate an issue, such a motion cannot be brought by JNOV, but must be brought by a 50B motion. Republic urges this court to apply a de novo standard But ultimately, what Republic seeks the court to do is hold that the trial court erred by failing to reduce damages under breach of contract, Rule 59A9. Rather, the issue should be ultimately determined by abuse of discretion. But ultimately, Tesser should prevail under either standard. Even examined under de novo standard of review, the court must examine whether JNOV is appropriate under 50B, which required the court to view the evidence in the light most favorable to the non-movement, Tesser, so that reasonable minds can come to only one conclusion. Under the circumstances, the trial court properly decided that the question of waiver was a jury question. The second issue is the jury instructions on the breach of contract. And the Ninth District has long recognized that the preparation of jury instructions is the province of the trial court, and the Court of Appeals will not disturb that decision absent an abuse of discretion. That's the Callahan case from this district in 2005.
But we don't look at abuse of discretion when it's an issue of law. I mean, you can't just put a completely erroneous issue of law and couch it in terms of a jury instruction and then say it's an abuse of discretion standard.
Your Honor, that's correct. But this court has deferred when there are questions. And in fact, really even the way the issue was characterized is there is some discretion as to how to issue a breach of contract instruction. And in this situation, in fact, there are really two parts of the objection. First, there seems to be an objection as to the format, the listing of itemized items. And in fact, Tesser itemized 9 items, Republic itemized 11 items. And that approach directly tracks the Ohio jury instructions. And this court says, while not mandatory, the Ohio jury instructions are preferred.
Counsel, the items that Tesser itemized as possible breaches, do I understand that correctly? That's what they were?
They were alleged to be breaches, Your Honor.
Do they track with the complaint?
Your Honor, I think some did, and in fact, many of them did. I'd have to look side by side. There was a laundry list in the complaint and a laundry list in the allegations. But the issues that were raised were not novel at the time of jury instruction. They were the subject of extensive testimony and extensive discussion. And in fact, that's with regard to the instructions as we've itemized in our brief. In fact, Republic Steel acknowledged, it seems the biggest controversy seems to be implied duties. Republic Steel acknowledged that implied duties were duties owed by Republic Steel. For example, in the discussion of whether the materials that were supplied must meet industry standards, in the discussion, the sub-discussion of the itemized list, Republic's own attorneys acknowledged that, I guess, is an implied contractual term. No objection to that one. And that's the transcript of 3015. So the ones that seem to be in controversy now seem to be the failure to coordinate and means and methods. Republic's wrong that these somehow erroneously discuss Ohio law. First of all, Tesser has pointed to the Valentine case, which recognizes that an owner, not surprisingly, has a duty to coordinate work in all construction matters. But if this was somehow in doubt, Republic Steel plant manager James Hardy, who testified, was asked this question. Question, you would agree with me that Republic was responsible for coordinating among the various contractors in the project, wouldn't you? Answer, coordinating the project, yes. So this wasn't a controversial allegation. It was the subject of testimony for which Republic's own witnesses acknowledged. The remaining one that seems to be in controversy is that an independent contractor can control its means and methods. This has been the law in Ohio since 1926 at least. And so the issues that seem to be being brought attention to are not difficult. But more importantly, Ohio recognizes the two-issue rule, which means that if there are separate and independent issues, and in this case, there are numerous elements on that for which there is literally no dispute at all, it's acknowledged, such as payment, then the court will not speculate as to which of the proper instructions the jury relied upon and which they did not. If this was such a big issue for Republic Steel could have asked a jury interrogatory to say, did you rely on this instruction? Is this the breach? Is it the means and methods? Is that the breach that you're alleging? Is the failure to coordinate, is that what's alleged? And so again, First of all, there was no mistake made with regard to the instructions, either in the format or in the itemization. But second, there was, even if there was, the unjust enrichment rule would still demonstrate that Tessar should succeed on that issue. The third issue is unjust enrichment and the award of $462,128. Frequently, when looking into an award, courts will look to an inconsistent verdict. In this case, we have exactly the opposite. We have a consistent verdict. There's no dispute that that the jury was properly instructed on unjust enrichment. There's no dispute that the jury answered the jury interrogatories correctly. There's no dispute that the jury was polled and confirmed their verdict. So, Republic isn't pointing out some error in the process. Republic is asking this court to speculate as to an inconsistency because the jury adopted a number used elsewhere in the case. They describe it as coincidental. We don't describe it as coincidental. They obviously used a number from somewhere else in the case. But the question is, the mere fact that the jury used a number properly heard elsewhere in the case, does that disqualify the verdict? Now, we've pointed to the Nelson Jewelry case, but Republic attempts to distinguish the case law that we have cited in support of this, for example, the Teslon case. The Teslon case involved an actual expert report that was delivered to the jury. The jury then awarded damages, and the only place they could have gotten that number was from the expert report. That was prejudicial to the party and was properly overturned because in that situation, there was essentially an investigation. Where did they get the number? Answer, improper evidence. And for that reason, it was appropriate. The same can be said with regard to some of the other cases that are cited. When the court can look into it and try and understand where they got the number, the court could then draw conclusions from that. But in this situation, the conclusion is they got the number from an appropriate time. And ultimately, when the jury made its determination, they agreed upon a number that they heard somewhere else. Now, Republic has urged this court, at least in briefing, to treat this like a JNOV issue. But as they were here, we heard them discussing it as a remitter issue. Again, to the extent that this is remitter, the standard is the abuse of discretion standard. And so when reviewing what the court did, the court who heard the evidence of unjust enrichment, heard the full amount of the trial, the question is really, for an error in judgment, that it implies the trial court's attitude was arbitrary, unreasonable, or unconscionable. But there is no suggestion that the trial court was arbitrary, unreasonable, or unconscionable in its determination upholding a verdict. As we said earlier, Tessar's damages that it ultimately requested were greatly in excess of the sum of the damages that were ultimately awarded to Tessar. And so it's not like Tessar has been fully compensated, which some of the cases that Republic points to have, and then they're trying to somehow double dip by getting some additional award. Here, Tessar did not reach even the damages it ultimately sought. At trial, the jury heard extensive testimony about the work that Tessar performed and that Republic claimed was the subject of no contract. One important fact is Republic's own expert witness was asked about what he called an earned income analysis, and he concluded that Tessar earned $8.3 million, which benefited Republic, but only paid Tessar $7.2 million. So at a minimum, Republic's own expert confirmed that there was a benefit given to Republic Steel for which Tessar was unpaid. Now, Your Honor, we of course have a cross appeal, and my time is short. But as explained in the briefs, the trial court made one mistake, and that was to take a question away from the jury. This court reviews this action de novo, and upon review, it is clear that Tessar provided substantial evidence that Gustavo Gunter fabricated the existence of lower bidders and induced Tessar to modify its bid. In fact, case law is clear that false statements that are made in the course of negotiations, the Haler case, the Costa case, each indicate that there is that kind of information are falsehoods. The evidence at trial was quite clear. Mr. Gunter said it was true. We don't disagree with that. But he was also asked, did you write the number down? Did you get a written proposal? Did you get information from these people? Did they appear on Republic's own spreadsheets? Was this bid actually based on the bidding documents? And Mr. Gunter had to admit time after time after time, he couldn't substantiate that number anywhere. And then with regard to the damages, Tessar ultimately was requested to be paid in full for its first contract. The two contracts were distinct. And the first contract was for a fixed amount. The second was a recovery contract. And it was done with open books. And so the minimum impact of Mr. Gunter's lies was to lower Tessar's profit by $170,000. The jury and the trial court heard the case for 4 weeks, 14 witnesses, and 500 exhibits. They entered an award in favor of Tessar, and all jury interrogatories were consistent with the award. Tessar urges this court to leave the express will of the jury undisturbed and uphold the prior verdict and only return to the court the question of fraud.
Thank you. You have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, beginning with the jury instructions issue, counsel has discussed the standard of review for remitter, again focused on the wrong standard of review in his presentation, and also has conflated what Republic has argued is the error here. They are focusing on itemization itself and going back to the Ohio jury instruction. Our point is that enumerated breaches should at the very least correspond to the contract. And we pointed that out very clearly to the trial court, and the trial court proceeded anyway. And the cases we've cited in our brief make the point that once you've made your position clear, and once you've submitted a legally correct jury instruction, you have satisfied your obligation. And that recognizes the tension between preserving an issue for appeal and also trying to do your best with the playing field that the trial court has set. One of the questions that was asked was whether the breaches track the complaint. I just looked through the complaint and I don't believe those breaches were set forth. This wasn't teed up before the trial court until the jury instructions were actually being debated, and at that point the Republic's counsel very clearly asked the court, it explained that it felt that the court was instructing the jury on non-existent contract duties.
Can I ask you a question? Your wording there is curious to me. Did counsel object?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
Counsel objected. Counsel said that it believed that the it was being instructed on duties that were not in the contract. I'd like to also address the contract cap issue. The Tessar is relying, again, very heavily on Exhibit 207, which is the email from Mr. Qualls. And they're pointing to the fact that Mr. Qualls was saying that we want to manage the work on a time and materials basis. That goes to the billing method. It doesn't go to the contract cap. As I discussed in my opening presentation, those are different aspects of the party's relationship. Tessar also is focused on the remedy here, but we cited cases in our briefs on remitter, and we've argued for remitter on the cap issue. The Ohio Supreme Court Moskowitz case that we cited sets forth the standard. This court has independent power over the amount of the verdict. It doesn't defer. That we explained that the standard that Tessar has cited applies to new trial motions, not to remitter in our brief. And they continue to conflate those two standards in their remarks. And finally, on the contract cap issue, the testimony was quoted from our expert, Mr. Wolf, that there was a working system in place. But the actual quotation there is that work was being directed that was the extra work that was outside the scope of the contract in this case. So it would not be governed by the contract cap and would not be a waiver of the contract cap. On unjust enrichment, again, Tessar is saying that this is speculation, that our argument is speculation, and that they're trying to distinguish the Telchon case by saying, well, we knew where the number came from in Telchon, but we don't know here. We certainly do know here. It's no mystery. We know precisely where the number came from. It came from the chart that Tessar put before the jury to summarize its consequential contract damages. And contract damages can't form a basis for an unjust enrichment verdict. We objected at the time to when the jury came back with its verdict on the record. And the trial court didn't act on that. It didn't pull the jury, even though we raised the issue immediately. The fact that there isn't additional evidence is not the fault of Republic, but the evidence that does exist is quite clear. It's the number in the verdict mapped onto the evidence at trial. Briefly on the cross-appeal issue, we think that Tazar continues to fail to substantiate any damages here, and they continue to fail to show that even if there was a false statement, which we dispute, and even if they had relied, which we also dispute, that reliance could have been reasonable. It's simply unreasonable to throw out the detailed cost estimates that you have done, knowing your own labor costs and your own input costs, and then subsequently rely on what maybe it might cost somebody else to do the same work. That is unreasonable as a matter of law. And even if there had been a misrepresentation that they relied on, they can't show that that caused them harm, because when they did the second purchase order, they set the price, and they had the opportunity to tell the public what they wanted to be paid for that work. They took the outstanding amount from the first purchase order and simply applied it to the second purchase order. If they had been owed more on the first purchase order, if the first purchase order had been more money, had been this $170,000 more, they would have simply deducted that amount from the second purchase order. It all adds up to the same amount at the end of the day. And they had the opportunity, when they were aware that their initial bid was too low, to reprice, and they haven't shown any damages as a consequence of that.
And with that, ma'am, you're out of time.
If there are no further questions, thank you very much. We would ask the court to reverse.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement, issue a written decision, which we mail to both sides, as well as posted to our website and at the Supreme Court. With that, the court is adjourned until Thursday.